It's just wonderful. You're going to be hearing from them one by one as time comes up. And this is really momentous. I started in the post office in 1966. And ever since I've been here, regardless of what administration has been in power, Democrat or Republican, the theme has always been cut, 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 understaff, understaff, understaff. It's gotten worse lately, but it's always been bad. It would come in waves, and each wave was worse than the last. And it's part of this whole philosophy of you cut and you cut and you cut, and the money goes to the people at the very top. And you know, finally one country, Greece, is standing against this and actually saying what we all know, that the way that you have an economy going is to have a system where everybody can work and everybody can share distribution of the money. That cutting, cutting, cutting does not work. It just hurts everybody, the workers, the people who need their postal service, and on and on. Part of the problem is the Board of Governors of the Postal Service. They are all from the large mailers council, and their main interest is preserving their 17 cents, the first class letter rate, while the rest of us pay 49 cents. And we need to have a Board of Governors reorganized so it represents somebody from the unions, or more than, for the different unions, more than one person from the unions, some people from the small businesses, but mostly people who just want to get their mail. And so,
Benny,
thank you for all for being here, and we're going to have our next speaker, which is going to be Alan Fisher from the American Federation of Teachers 2121, a City College professor.
Yay! Okay, I bring everybody greetings from City College in San Francisco. Woo! Together with the postal workers in the same fight. In experiencing a manufactured financial crisis, just like the postal workers are, in the case of the postal workers being demanded to pay, millions and millions of dollars in the future for retiree benefits, they are demanding the same thing from City College. City College experienced a $55 million cut in funding, and then the accreditation team turns around and blames City College for financial instability. So what I'm saying is that the postal workers and education workers are being hit. Are moving away with access to drive our wages down to try to de-unionize our workers, and we gotta support each other in this fight. You know, it's a corporate agenda to privatize public services and privatize as much as they can, because they believe that's the way to increase profit. And we need to protect the working people of this country. Gather together and fight. And also, we need to pay attention to the fact that this country now has a very militarized economy, and it's time for our country, the United States, to stop having bases all around the world, over thousand bases, and it's time to convert the militarized economy into an economy of good jobs for working people, increase the services for the public.
Yes.
For people who don't want to wait in line an hour to get their postal needs served, just like we at City College do. We're trying so hard to satisfy the needs of our students, but the people in power are trying to bring us the resources, all these resources to carry out our mission of serving the public, right?
Yeah.
So, once again, glad to see everybody here. Thank you for coming. Let's carry on this fight. Thank you.
All right. Thank you,
brother. From SEIU Home Girl.
Thank you. I want to start out by thanking the postal workers who have, under incredibly rough
tough circumstances, maintain our service in this country, and with understaffing, with the attacks on them, with the privatization, they loyally and dedicatedly serve the public of the United States, and I want to thank you so much, because home care workers like you as public sector are facing the same kind of starve-the-beast baloney of making people wait in line, making people not have access to the services that we need, and I applaud you for standing up, for doing this, for fighting for everyone's postal service. It's a mark of civilization to have a postal service.
Yes.
And in country after country, unfortunately, things are being privatized further. And so, thank you for standing up. Thank you for standing up for the public service and for your brothers and sisters. Hooray for the fact that there is an effort to get reform in the Postal Service on the board of directors, on the governors. Right now, average people are not represented. The big corporations, the big institutions are represented, and the individual and people who represent working people are not on there. So we've got to keep fighting for that. We've got to keep fighting for full funding for public services so that we don't have to wait forever to have a service. It's not right. But hooray for those people that face that understaffing and the problem with that every day, and loyally serve and help the public with their postal needs and the service that we have to have. So let's work to get rid of these people that want to privatize the public services and starve them and shut them down.
Yeah,
whether it be
hungry.
The Postal Service, whether it be home care, whether it be Medi-Cal, whether it be, you know, across the board with education, etc. That's what we need, and we need a political manifestation. We see in this city a Democratic Party now that's run by the real estate people, that's directed by the billionaires, and the Republican Party don't even mention. I mean, the Democrats are beginning to look like them. We need a party of working people, working politics. That's what we need in the city. Join your working politics club and fight for a city for everyone. Thank
yes.
you so much.
Yes.
I remember the U.S. is a postman. The U.S. is a postman.
The basis for it, we provide the dues to the unions, which can help.
done the organizing of all these people that don't have a union, that don't have a living wage, that have to scrape together two or three jobs just to support their family.
Amen.
Or have no job at all, or live on the street. I mean, this is outrageous.
Yeah.
Another thing, there's a new development happening in the grassroots in this country. And that is, there's this tremendous effort to organize the unorganized, and there's also this tremendous effort to do away with this police brutality that's happening directly and particularly at black people or black and brown people in this country.
Yeah.
And we have to put a stop to it. Can you imagine how strong we would be if these two movements united into one movement?
Yeah.
Can you imagine how strong we would be?
Yeah.
And the last thing I just want to say that we've been having a fight to save the Berkeley Postal.
Yeah.
And recently, we've been going almost 3 years now to take the Berkeley Post Office. We've had occupation. We had a 33-day occupation a year and a half ago, and now there's a six-month-long occupation of the Post Office 24/7. There's been a legislation by the city of Berkeley, and the entire city of Berkeley government stands in favor of keeping the Post Office. And Recently, a judge ruled that the post office, if they decide to sell it, which they said they wanted to do, if they decide to move the services, the window services, they have to give us 42 days notice, that's 6 weeks, to organize another suit or whatever. All I can say is we want to spread this across the country. We want the every endangered post office. You know, in San Francisco, there were four post offices that were threatened with the closure in 2010. And there were tremendous demonstrations, and the hearings were packed, and there was an occupation of the Civic Center post office. And at the end of it all, the post office said they're not going to close. So struggle pays off, sisters and brothers.
Yeah! United we stand!
You see that it's very important. The thing that is happening to the family working neighborhoods. They try to display these people who have to build up new condos, new houses that can be afforded only for rich people. That is happening with rich people. But a mysterious fire comes, and nobody knows how those fires start. But after those fires, what is that? Become new buildings for the new people, for the rich people. The black and the brown community, they stand and fight back to stop this insanity police. The Mission neighborhood community, they stand and fight back to stop this displacement. We, the postal workers, we, the community, we can do something to stop this madness of the postal office to try to be privatized. And they stand and fight back.
Yeah.
I'm going to say, stand, you say, fight back.
Yeah.
Stand up.
Stand up!
Now we're going to have our brother come, plumber, for the living wage for legal. He's going to say some words. Okay? So.
Sure will.
Hi, on behalf of the San Francisco Living Wage Coalition, we're here to express our solidarity with the postal workers. Why? Because, have you ever heard the expression, you can always get a job at the post office?
No more.
Well, that expression signifies something. That signifies that the post office has always been a source of jobs for African American and Latino communities because it has an integrated workforce. And that isn't by accident. That took place because you all, as the workers before you, had organized unions and made the sacrifice of some very long strikes. And from that you won affirmative action. From that you won jobs that are approaching a living wage. I don't think you're all making a living wage. I think you should make a hell lot more.
Yes.
But you do have some good paying jobs. That precisely is why the Republicans in Congress are attacking you.
Yes.
That
yes.
is why Congress wants to dismantle the Postal Service.
Yes.
That is why post offices are being closed all across the country. Jobs are being cut. You all are having to work now 13-hour days because they are not hiring additional people. They don't want more people having living wage jobs. This is all about pushing people down to the bottom. All around the world, growing income inequality is epidemic. To bolster the wealth of the 1%. And you all are on the front lines of fighting that. You all are fighting to have a fair economy to turn things around. If you lose, we all lose. That is why we are here expressing our solidarity with you and why we're not here. Thank you very much and continue to fight.
Woo! Thank you, Roosevelt. Seeing their costs. Now, Twitter is getting a tax break here in these high-tech companies. So these billionaires are getting tax subsidies, and working people are getting pay cuts.
Yeah.
And we have to stop that. And we have to say that there has to be an end to privatization. We need a national campaign against privatization. They blame teachers for not teaching when they're scapegoating the teachers, when they're bringing charter schools and trying to destroy public education. It's the same thing that's happened to the post office. They want to privatize and turn it over to private companies that raise the prices. So when we talk about the postal workers, we're talking about defending not only the postal workers, but all working people, the public, so they have a decent post office. It was set up by Benjamin Franklin. It's in the Constitution, but apparently they don't pay attention to the Constitution. They're ready to get rid of the post office, even though it says we have a right to it, the people of the United States. Now, the other issue I want to bring up is workplace bullying. Because there's an epidemic in this country against attacks on working people.
Yeah.
And in the post office, workers have been killed, managers have been killed by an atmosphere of bullying and targeting working people, harassing them. Even in San Francisco, there's been workplace violence. That's a direct result of the management of these companies wanting to intimidate and terrorize workers, to turn them into robots so their conditions deteriorate and they end up blaming each other. We're saying we need to stop workplace bullying. We have to unite working people in this country against the harassment, against the terrorism, and against those workers who want to join a union. Because if you want to join a union, what happens to you? You get fired.
Yeah.
They fire thousands and thousands of workers who want to join unions, even though it's illegal. So we have to fight for full unionization. Now, in 1934, there was a general strike in San Francisco. And as a result of that general strike, hundreds of thousands of workers joined unions. The reason they joined unions, they weren't afraid anymore. And if we have a workers' movement in this country that backs workers up, millions of workers would join unions. Like the fast food workers, like the Walmart workers. They closed 5 Walmarts in this country to prevent them from unionizing. And they call this a democracy. That's illegal, but they do it. We're saying workers have a right to have a union. The postal workers have a right to decent wages and a decent contract. And there's a lot of money. There's a lot of money which they're saying that should go into their pension fund. Well, I say take it out of the billionaires in California. Let these people pay for our pensions. They're the ones that have stolen the money from us. Let them pay for it. Lastly, I want to say that on Thursday, this coming Thursday, there's going to be a representative of the National Union of Metal Workers, Dinga Sabu, who's coming from South Africa, and they've been fighting privatization and deregulation like we have in the United States, and he's going to be talking about the fight of the unions to form a united front in South Africa, and for the formation of a national workers' party that will defend all working people. We need to look to the workers of South Africa who have a lot of experience in fighting racist apartheid and also fighting the United States working class. So thank you. Solidarity. Victory to the postal workers.
Woo! Part of that great national strike in 1970, which changed and improved the conditions of postal workers across this country. And don't you know that that strike started out as a wildcat strike? It was a proposal by a union member in one local, and it spread like fire across this country, where all the unions together in the post office came out the several days. President Nixon tried to get the National Guard to come out to replace the postal workers and couldn't do it because it was the postal workers that had been trying to get country. It was the postal workers who reached every household every day. It was an important public service in addition to guaranteeing communication. And all these attempts at privatization, including making the postal workers pay billions of dollars, years, decades ahead of the requirement for their medical care, is trying to sweeten the pot for the corporations that want to buy it at a bargain price from the people of this country. And so, just like the national strike that took place in 1970, it's necessary for the postal workers' union to unite, to try to find a way to overcome the different expiration dates of the contract, the attempts of the government to divide the postal workers' union, not only from between themselves, but from other unions as well. We're facing an enormous crisis in the United States, where labor is increasingly under the attack. Despite all the desires of workers to join a union, everyone knows how almost impossible it is to join without the risk of being fired or other means of repression. But the postal workers are greatly admired by people in this country. They're greatly admired. It's one of the most important organized workforces, respected by the people, and we demand no privatization. We demand that the bosses sit down at the table with the American Postal Workers Union and negotiate a decent contract. Unity with the post office. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah, I'm gonna
use
my extra large.
Thank you.